I am indeed extremely thankful to MIT University and the Vice Chancellors. And just now I listened to Surya Prakash Raju and Thiruvai Sugam. So I am indeed thankful to them. And now let us start. I have been to this university after the tsunami, Sumatran tsunami of 2004, along with my Canadian friend. He was a seismologist from Canada, and we have visited it site for about 2 days. We have walked, and we have seen now that how all things are plus. At that time, we have seen so many things, and it was perhaps for the first time that Indian coast was hit by tsunami. However, that time we have forgotten that during 1945, there was a tsunami on west coast at Kandla. So these people, they have forgotten. Moreover, I have written a paper way back in 1976. Way back in 1976, and that was published in Tsunami International Society of Tsunami Journal in 1976. And I'm very happy about it. So let us now start from what we have done and what we have not done. Now, after the 2004 tsunami, it was said that India is not vulnerable to tsunami, and it is only to Pacific region, and we should not bother about it, etc. But when I had published the paper 1976 with Canadian friend, Mr. Murthy, Professor Murthy, he was my friend from Canada. He and myself, we visited the site for about 2 days. We walked along the coast and surveyed it. We have presented a paper. So that is available with Dr. Thiruvengata Swami. And what I will say that you can see this paper. Now, another point is people, once you get subject, then they go on talking till the tsunami occurred on Indian coast. There was no tsunamologist in India. But the day after, there were so many tsunamologists in India. And now, let us see what we can see, some of the video, some of the, what I would like to say. Another thing was myself and Thiruvengata Swami have published a paper. Now, when the tsunami hit the Indian coast, it hit right from southern tip of India up to Odisha or Paradip port or so. But then we were discussing, myself and Dr. Thiruvengata Swami, why the tsunami magnitude is same, the height of the tsunami is fluctuating. So we have found that the maximum destruction due to tsunami had occurred at Nagapattinam and Thailand. Nagapattinam and Thailand, they were just at right angles to the direction of rupture of the tsunami, direction of rupture on the ground. the direction of rupture was about 1170 kilometers underground. And it took about 7 minutes, 10 seconds for the entire thing to crack. Then the tsunami started. So then we checked the heights of tsunami from all the locations and found that Nagapattinam and Thailand more or less equidistant from the tsunami point generation have suffered maximum. But at the same time, just below that in the south, there is a Cocos Island, which is also at the same distance or similar distance. So that also we have found at Cocos Island, the tsunami height was just 42 centimeters. So this has given us a new direction that when the tsunami waves are generated, the maximum destructive power or maximum amplitude of the wave is in the direction at right angles to the rupture of the, and it is minimum in the direction of the rupture. In this case, I will give you an example that after this, every country wanted money and all that thing. They were asking international associations, we want money and all that thing. Bangladesh also. Bangladesh had no tsunami at all. But somehow, because of some other reason, they asked for $2 million for tsunami protection of the coast. And I oppose it, but they were never given. So let us forget about it. And now let me see what we have in my PPT. I will tell you one more thing is about those who have seen Calcutta city. Calcutta has expanded to include Salt Lake City. But what is Salt Lake? Nobody knows. I will tell you that there was a big lake and that was giving fish to Calcutta. So for expansion, they have done, which is now a very interesting thing. Calcutta port has maximum sedimentation take place there. So there was a pipeline was constructed about 8 kilometers long, 1.5 meter diameter, and the silt collected at Calcutta port was transported and dumped in this area. It took about 11 years to completely close the lake, and then they have done this thing. So now with this, let us see what is the next thing is. In case a tsunami will not come to Calcutta, but a heavy rainfall or an earthquake takes place, the Salt Lake City can go down. It is filled with sediment only, and the depth, the height of the sediment field varies between 1 meter to 3 meters. Now I am coming to the next point is that now at present, what are the research needs to be done? It is seen that most of us, ocean scientists, ocean engineers, and tsunamologists, they fully depend, or more or less, they depend on foreign resources. We have a center at Hyderabad, INQAS. It has been giving good service, but what they are doing is they take data from the US and then talk. So what I will request the MIT University that they must concentrate on developing some of the parameters. Now some parameters are such which could be used or which may not be used. Some of the parameters what I have experienced and found, there are two types of parameters for tsunami warning or earthquake warning. What are really useful is electronics. So, and biological parameters. Biological parameters, I may tell you that after the tsunami, I visited Nagapattinam Hospital. And they say that the number of delivery cases has increased too much. So I went to Nagapattinam Civil Hospital and found that on an average, there were about 3 to 4 cases of delivery. And the day, 2 days before that, it was 12. And on the day of tsunami, it was 21. So we should believe this, whether you agree or not. I will tell you one more thing is, now, this is horrible, unimaginable, what is there. So I will not describe it much. Now, this is uprooting of tree. And I would like to tell you one thing, that we have tried something in Andaman coast. The biological protection is quite useful. If you place the trees along the shore, it reduces the tsunami height. Now you come to this. This is the number of deaths and damage, all that thing will not go. Now, the climate, cyclone, lightning, etc. All the damages, what we have seen is this. I think I may take another, shall I? No, I have got one more slide and some time. What damage the tsunami had caused at Kalpakkam and Kudamkulam. Now, but before that, I would like to tell you that there are two more points which were not considered in any previous papers. These are the tsunamigenic vulnerability of coastal airports. It includes airport in Kerala, Tamil Nadu. Then Visakhapatnam is a very unique airport. It is almost like a oval shape in between. There is the all surrounding, there are hills, and in between, there is airport. Similarly, the position of the Mangalore airport, but Mangalore, you will may not experience much tsunami also. Now coming to Kerala and Tamil Nadu airports, we have to see very seriously that two points have to be seen: the directivity of tsunami waves and the warning system. The Cochin, Trivandrum airports are just few, maybe 1 or 2 or 3 kilometers. Similar is the case with Port Blair Airport. Port Blair, while landing, you will feel that whether you are landing in sea or landing on a airport. So for this purpose, we have to clearly define, and only defining is not useful, but we have to take engineering measures to overcome this thing. This is what is required. But sometimes the nature power is so high that man fails. I'll give you an example of Nicobar Airport. Okay, start now, question now.
Yes, sir. So the question have been asked that what are all the parameters that has been affecting this tsunami generation, sir?
Normally, tsunami is generated within the earthquake occurs at time t. Suppose time t, and tsunami occurs within t plus 150 seconds maximum. It may be 50 seconds, 100 seconds, 120 seconds, but it takes t plus 150 seconds, that is the time when tsunami generated and the wave they travel, the velocity, etc., that we know. So next question.
Yes, sir, it is clear. The next question, sir, what is the most general form of tsunami that's been happening in the Tamil Nadu coastal area, sir?
What is the
general form of pattern, sir? They are asking about the pattern of generation of this tsunami.
You see, if this, because the tsunami in Bay of Bengal will occur due to earthquakes in Andaman and Indonesia. These are the two vulnerable areas for earthquake, tsunami-genic earthquake. So, and then from that, you can see that Tamil Nadu is just on the at right angles to that. So we cannot mitigate or do anything to stop this, but we can do some mitigation measures. That I will tell you if you want.
Thank you, sir. So another question has been asked is, what is the difference in between the major ports and minor ports?
Oh, there are, I think we have discussed this already in our paper, myself and Thiru Venkataswamy, but major ports are those with capacity handling is allowed there. So we have so many major ports, right from starting from Kandla, Mumbai, Mangalore, Cochin, then Cochin, then Chennai, like that it goes on. An additional port recently added was the Paradip port in west of Odisha. But minor ports are so many, what I have shown you in my previous slide, dotted areas, those are the small. In Maharashtra, it is Ratnagiri. In Tamil Nadu, it can be some small region. And in Andhra Pradesh, there are so many. So whether classification is purely based on facilities to berth the boat, etc.
Sir, thank you, sir, for your innovative session. We are having one more question, sir, about this tsunami pattern in the south coastal India. What is the maximum intensity it generates, sir?
Where?
South coast.
Whether it is in the east coast or west coast?
West coast, sir. West coast, sir.
East coast. So yes, the maximum tsunami height which could be generated on the east coast of India, we have seen it went up to about 5 meters or 6 meters or so. Beyond that, it has not gone.